Boston Harbor cleanup represents one of the largest public works projects ever undertaken in New England. Once considered the dirtiest harbor in America, today it's recognized as one of America's greatest environmental achievements.
When we started the harbor cleanup, this water was so filthy that no one wanted to be down here. People in Boston didn't seem to care that much about it. They just accepted it. That was what the harbor was supposed to be like.
For generations, we've been cut off from the harbor. In essence, the harbor was surrounded by brownfields and abandoned parking lots, was polluted to the point where it was not just unsafe, but it was fairly unpleasant.
By the mid-1980s, Boston Harbor had become the dirtiest harbor in the United States. For more than a century, the daily waste from Boston and 43 surrounding communities went virtually untreated before being dumped into the harbor. Finally, in 1985, EPA joined the Conservation Law Foundation, the City of Quincy, and the Town of Winthrop in a federal lawsuit seeking compliance with the Clean Water Act. EPA was then charged by the court to cooperate in and ensure the expeditious design, funding, and construction of the necessary facilities to clean up Boston Harbor. The court ordered the Commonwealth of Massachusetts to transfer responsibility for sewage management to the Massachusetts Water Resources Authority, the MWRA.
When the authority was created, they inherited an antiquated, rundown, ineffective sewer system from a state agency that had been neglected for many years.
The project involved hundreds of individual construction projects, and every one of those had its own complications. And just knowing that there were that many people out there working on this project was just a great feeling. It wasn't any more that EPA was in this alone. We actually had thousands of people working to clean up the harbor.
Many obstacles threatened to stall the project. The massive plant cost billions of dollars, and ratepayers protested their increasing sewer bills. Citizens worried the discharge outfall was still too close to Boston, while others argued it was too close to the Cape and might impact marine life.
As soon as the sludge stopped being dumped, you could almost see the difference in terms of water clarity.
The harbor restoration didn't end with the building of the Deer Island treatment plant. Since 2005, the EPA has stayed involved, and the MWRA has tackled projects to eliminate the combined sewer overflows that occur during rainstorms.
We're seeing the return of a lot of sensitive marine species to areas of the harbor that at one time was considered some of the most contaminated spots. Now we see everything from small fish, sticklebacks, to large predators like sand tiger sharks, and just about everything in between. So it's just a wonderful story of recovery and hope.
I mean, I joke sometimes that the most popular bird here is really the crane, because every place you turn on the waterfront, you're seeing so many cranes building new buildings. People want to be on the waterfront, and it's because it's clean. It has become the engine for economic development. And we're all of a sudden getting this critical mass of mixes of residential, commercial uses, cultural institutions, all coming to the waterfront. You know, 15, 20 years ago, you never would have been able to attract that caliber of firms or retail uses. You know, it has cost us many billions of dollars as ratepayers, but in return, we have had a renaissance of this waterfront, and the development that we have seen is unprecedented.
The incredible thing about it is that we succeeded and the water is clean, and if we can clean up Boston Harbor, we can clean up anything.
I think that our generation will be looked at as the visionaries by our children and our grandchildren's generations, who will say, you know, they paid a heavy price in terms of cleaning up this harbor, but my goodness, what they have left for our generation.